Evening, everyone. Welcome to Atlanta History Center's virtual author talk series. My name is Claire Haley, and I'm the Strategic Communications Director here for the History Center. I'm absolutely thrilled to be welcoming you here virtually this evening. We're joined by author Ben Beard in conversation with Matthew Bernstein, and they will be discussing Ben's newest book, The South Never Plays Itself. So you can purchase a copy of Ben's book from our official bookseller, Acapella Books. After I finish this intro, there'll be, yes, there it is, from Matthew. So it's a really great, really great book. Please purchase it from our local independent bookstore and official bookseller, Acapella Books. There'll be a link to do that in the chat here shortly. During the event tonight, Matthew and Ben will be taking your questions during the last 10 minutes of the program. So as you think of them, please use the Q&A feature to submit those, and we'll get to as many as we can here at the end of the program. I'm going to briefly introduce tonight's guests, and I'm going to turn it over to them because I have a really exciting conversation planned for you this evening. So Ben Beard is a writer and librarian. He is the co-author of This Day in Civil Rights History and the author of Muhammad Ali, The Greatest and King Midas in Reverse. In the 2000s, Beard reviewed movies and wrote features for Insight Magazine, King Kudzu, and FilmMonthly.com, where he also worked as an editor. Beard, a native of Georgia who spent his formative years in the Florida Panhandle, in Alabama, currently lives in Chicago with his wife and three children. He is always working on a new book. Matthew Bernstein is tonight's moderator. He is a professor, chair, and director of graduate studies in the Film Studies Department at Emory University. He's the author or editor of four books, including John Ford Made Westerns, Filming the Legend in the Sound Era, and Walter Wanger, Hollywood Independent. So two huge film buffs with a great conversation, some fun clips for you tonight. I'm really looking forward to it. Don't forget to submit your questions in the Q&A. And Matthew and Ben, welcome to Atlanta History Center.
Great, thank you, Claire. So great to be here. Ben, welcome to Atlanta virtually.
Thanks, Matthew. Thanks, Claire.
You grew up in the South. Tell us more about that. Obviously, that's a factor in writing this book.
Sure. I was born in Atlanta, and I moved to Pensacola, Florida when I was about seven. And then I went to college in Montgomery, Alabama, and moved. And then I got a job there. And then I moved back to Atlanta in my mid-20s before leaving the South, and have not moved back. But I would say if I was born in Atlanta and grew up in Pensacola and educated in Alabama, my real, I was really raised by the movies.
That's wonderful. So what, when were you in Atlanta and what were you doing while you were here?
You mean as an adult? So I was in the kind of Ponce, North Highlands area, and I was working at a used bookstore and writing movie reviews and interviewing actors and directors, and is sort of living a bohemian life, writing novel manuscripts, and I didn't have any money, and I was happy.
That's great. That sounds ideal. What was the used bookstore?
The Atlanta Book Exchange. It was on North Highland. It's gone now.
Okay. So talking about your book, can you talk a little bit about why you called it The South Never Plays Itself?
Sure. I was playing off the title of the great documentary Los Angeles Plays Itself, which is a film that's just made of other film clips with a narrator talking about how Los Angeles is the most filmed city in the history of the world, but it's often misrepresented, or it's presented in a way that doesn't make any sense to the people who live there. And so I was toying with that in the title. I also wanted it to sound catchy, but the idea is that the South is often misrepresented either on purpose or on accident by outsiders or by people who have like a grudge or a chip on their shoulder in ways good and bad. And so to me, the South that I grew up in, which was beachy and you know, a bit backwater, but boozy and sort of suburban with a little urban flavor, and then Atlanta, right? Like this, that South wasn't on screen at all when I was a kid at all. And I watched movies all the time, even as a child. So I feel like there's a disconnect between the South on screen and the South in reality. And I think that that disconnect is like really important to our country. And so,
Absolutely. So folks, just so you have a sense of this, we're going to be talking about a range of films, some of them well-known, some of them lesser known, some about the South and aspects of the South, some of them specifically either shot or set in Georgia. And really, you know, one of the great things about Ben's book is he comes at the South on film from a multiplicity of angles. There are chapters on movies made from material written by Tennessee Williams or William Faulkner or Erskine Caldwell. He has chapters by locale, so Texas, Louisiana, Florida, for example, and then also chapters by series. So it's a really varied book, and it's this really unique combination of criticism, personal memoir, and just general observations about the country. And it's just a really fun read. And Ben, I mean, how many films did you watch for this book? Amazing.
Well, it's a lifetime. So before I moved to Iowa City with my wife. We weren't married at the time, but I moved to Iowa City with my wife, and I had already seen more movies than anyone I knew. And we didn't have any money. She was busy all the time. And I didn't know anybody, so I just went to the public library and would check out a movie a night. And it was all like the good stuff. It was all like, you know, top shelf Japanese, top shelf French, classic Hollywood, you know, award winners, cult films. And so for 2 years, you know, I watched 600 something films, right? And so that was all in the bank. And for this book in particular, I watched maybe 400 or 500 films. And then in the first draft, you know, the first draft is almost 700 pages. So the editor did a Herculean thing. The editor was my wife, did a Herculean thing to like get it mercilessly, but to get it in good shape. But yeah, I watched a ton of films. And really, the thing is, I did not realize how big a bite of an apple I was taking until I started digging into the movies. There are so many films from every decade, and they are so different from each other. And I decided not to take a straight chronological approach, but to kind of look at these different big themes or even sort of types of characters. And I discovered a lot, especially Tennessee Williams. I knew he was a big deal, but I didn't realize how big a deal he was in Hollywood until I started watching the films.
Well, it's really fabulous. And you write, the South is both a region and a thought experiment, real and fiction at the same time. The South is a place and an idea, but whose idea? That's one of the questions you're trying to answer in the book. And as my description of the structure of the book suggests, the South is many things, and it's many things to many different people. It's been represented in so many different ways. You know, it's funny because we talk about the Western as a genre that's defined by where it's set, unlike a musical, right? It's song and dance. That's defined by what people do in it. We don't have a genre called the Southern. Instead, we have this multiplicity of films set in the South that are really interesting and rich and kind of represent a national psyche in terms of how people regard the South. And that's really very popular. Potent and eloquent. So folks, do be asking the questions in the Q&A and we will get to them. But of course we need to start when we're talking about the South in film with D.W. Griffith's 1915 racist epic, The Birth of a Nation. We're gonna these clips will be like 2 minutes and we'll talk about them. But this is a sequence near the end of the film where the Ku Klux Klan is riding to the rescue, both of a family that's in a cabin isolated with some Northerners, and then to rescue Lillian Gish, who's in town and kidnapped by a biracial villain in the Thank you. really should, I should have set this up better. The film is about the South's experience of the Civil War and then the Reconstruction period. And then the film is apotheosizing the Ku Klux Klan as restoring order because empowered Blacks, you know, they have political power, they have guns, and in the logic of the film, they need to be subdued. And I know this film looks creaky to you, but in its day, in 1915, it blew people away. Griffith, if you can follow it, is a master of cutting from different spaces. He uses cross-cutting to create suspense, ride to the rescue. Lots to talk about here. We'll try to be brief. So when I was talking about the cross-cutting, you see the Klan outside, you see them come inside. Lillian Gish plays a woman from a northern family. The man who unmasks himself there at the end is the little colonel from the southern family in Piedmont, South Carolina, the setting. So the idea of the birth of a nation is the reunification of the white race. And putting down African Americans, formerly enslaved people. And this movie is kind of like the original sin of racism in Hollywood, and also kind of a format for the depiction of the South. I don't know, Ben, if you wanted to add anything to that.
Yeah, well, I'll say a few things. Like, I'm not a silent cinema guy, so I'm on like shaky ground, like with the sort of aesthetic side. This last sequence is really dynamite visually. However, this film, to me, it's handling something that's evil that caused actual harm in the world because the KKK reformed because of the popularity of the movie, basically. And then they started killing, you know, Black citizens and Jewish citizens and so on. And so it's like, it's so troubling. I wasn't sure, I never wanted to watch it. You know, I mean, I wasn't interested because it's painful to you know, it's a painful and nasty thing. It's also the reason Hollywood exists. It gave us so much of cinema comes from the movie. So it's like, you know, I don't know what to do with it, but I think that it gave us all the so many years of stereotypes like came from the movie too. And a lot of the actors are white actors in blackface. I mean, they didn't even employ Black actors. So it's like, you know, it's actually interesting, right? Because it gives us a glimpse of like the value system of the, what, the 1916, 1915, which isn't that long ago. And, you know, the KKK are the heroes. And I think that we have to like grapple with that, you know, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, it's a film of incredible artistry married with this reprehensible ideology. And that's the conundrum of what's involved. In 1915, we're coming to the end of the celebration of the 50th anniversary of the Civil War. And so Griffith's a Southerner, he's presenting the Southern point of view, and he's doing it incredibly effectively. And yes, as Ben is saying, movies have been trying to recover in terms of depiction of race and race relations ever since, and we've made a lot of progress. But this is where it begins. But I also, we wanted to also just remind you or let you know that this movie did not go unanswered. And perhaps some of you have heard of this amazing Black filmmaker named Oscar Michaud. He was making movies starting in the teens for Black audiences. And he was a writer, director. Other people didn't want to work with him. He was a novelist. So he was, I'll make my own scenes, my own films. And here I want to show you a scene from his most celebrated silent film, and it's called Within Our Gates. And it's about a Black woman who's trying to fund a school in the South, and she has a Northern philanthropist supporting her. But then there's this flashback scene in which Michaud actually depicts the lynching of her adopted family. And in this scene, he depicts an attempted sexual assault on our heroine by a white lynch. So these folks are building a pyre to burn the bodies of her parents. But here, as the intertitle explains, Sylvia, who's our heroine, is back at her house, doesn't know her parents have been killed. I'm going to stop it there, but what I just wanted to show you, it was important for us to stress to you that there are Black filmmakers who are responding. And what you have here is Michaud reversing the terms of The Birth of a Nation, right? Because in Birth of a Nation, we just saw Lillian Gish is tied up by this biracial, crazed, power-hungry man. And this film, Within Our Gates, and the sequence, you know, alludes to the reality of the rape of Black women in the South by powerful Southern white men. And not only that, Michaud is using Griffith's tools to reverse the story. He's cross-cutting between the burning of her parents' bodies and the assault on her. So where it's cross-cutting of the Klan riding to the rescue, here it's Sylvia trying to survive this onslaught. So it's a total reversal of the kind of romanticized vision of the South. And, you know, from there, we thought we'd just move along to, obviously, from Birth of a Nation, you have films like Gone with the Wind that are kind of a remake of Birth of a Nation in terms of establishing a peaceful, idyllic, romantic version of the South. But rather than talk only about Gone with the Wind, we thought we'd talk about a kind of pre-Gone with the Wind film that's lesser known. Ben, do you want to talk about Jezebel?
Sure. So my great-great uncle wrote this this screenplay. He was Owen Davis. I never met him. I have no connection to Hollywood at all, but this is, and he was well known for adapting popular novels to the stage. He was almost seen as a hack. But he won a Pulitzer for Icebound, and he wrote Jezebel. And Jezebel is really interesting for a couple of reasons. One, Warner Brothers was trying to rush it out to get out ahead of Gone with the Wind. It was written independent of Gone with the Wind, but everyone knew Gone with the Wind was going to be a smash. So they were rushing out. Betty Davis was up for the part of Scarlett O'Hara, and there's a lot of rumor and conflicting information as to why she didn't get the role. But she wanted it, And I think the story I landed on is that she was paired with Errol Flynn, and she didn't think Errol Flynn was any good and didn't want to take the role with Errol Flynn. And then anyway, so she ended up at Jezebel, and it's a film set in New Orleans, and it's where it's problematic. It's directed by William Wyler. So it's a classy, wonderfully filmed piece of work. It's got Henry Fonda, who is a tall drink of water, and it's got Bette Davis just dominating the film. And it's not perfect. It has some problematic racial stuff. However, it's not ignoring racism either. Racism and is the reality of slavery, even though it's not shown, is at the center of the film, because these two different characters on the are both, they want Bette Davis's affections. They are arguing on different sides of this issue. And so she's manipulating all the men in her life. So the movie's a very rich film. It's also like 95 minutes long. So, you know, it has a lot to recommend. And Matthew, I think you're going to introduce the actual scene we're going to watch.
Yeah, so Bette Davis plays Julie Marston. This is the 1850s New Orleans. So it's well before the Civil War. There are slaves in the film. But she's this feisty character like Scarlett O'Hara. And in many ways, she's like Scarlett. She's very modern. She's very defiant. And in this classic scene, I think everybody here is familiar with how outrageous Scarlett is. Bette Davis's character, who's engaged to Henry Fonda, insists on wearing an inappropriate dress to the big ball coming up in New Orleans. So take a look.
Bring that over here. Isn't it?
And vulgar.
Yes, isn't it? Come on, get me out of this.
Julie, what are you doing?
If it fits me, I'm going to wear it to the Olympus Bowl.
A red dress to the Olympus Bowl while you're out of your senses?
Mademoiselle, jeune fille, porte une robe comme ça. D'ailleurs, c'est une robe de cette Marie Vicaire.
That creature, Julie. You heard what Madame Poulain said. That infamous Vickers.
Mary Vickers couldn't possibly do it justice.
Child, you're out of your mind. You know you can't wear red to the Olympus Bowl.
Can't I? I'm going to. This is 1852, Dumplin. 1852, not the Dark Ages. Girls don't have to simper around in white just because they're not married.
In New Orleans, they do. Julie, you'd insult every woman on the floor.
Mademoiselle, your aunt, she's right. Look how beautiful this dress is.
Will you kindly get me out of this?
Julie, you can't be serious.
Never more serious in my life.
Yeah, so... gotta love Bette Davis, defiant Bette Davis.
It's a wonderful film, and if you like old movies and you haven't watched it, you're missing out, because it has just really memorable killer pieces. And I love when she was like, saucy, isn't it? And the other character goes, and vulgar.
Yes, absolutely. So, I guess we'll skip over Gone with the Wind. Just to say, not everyone has seen it, but it's a real reference point. But Gone with the Wind plays on similar themes, much more richly in Technicolor, a huge success and everything else. Gone with the Wind had a major premiere in Atlanta, and another film that had a major premiere in Atlanta was Walt Disney's film Song of the South. And Ben, do you want to say a few words about it? We'll look at it.
Sure. It's a can of worms. So like even talking about it can be challenging, because its defenders say it's a nice story and it's got a great performance. It's got two great performances from Black actors. Yeah. And it's about a friendship between a little boy and an older Black man. And it's got good songs, right? And all of those things are true. Right. But then the people who are saying this is one of the most racist films ever made, they say the Black characters have zero agency. The oppressive like structure that they're living in is completely ignored. They don't seem to have desires. They don't seem to have independent agency. And so the film is very problematic. And it's what's fascinating is Walt Disney hired, I want to say Walter Bernstein, the screenwriter, to work on the screenplay. And the first thing he said to him is, I don't want to make an anti-Black film. I want this film to be like a celebration, right? So they thought they were making a film that was affirming. And that shows the myopia of the, you know, the people involved and the era and stuff. But so I've seen this movie I mean, 40 times in my childhood. And my older sister and I went to the theatrical re-release in the 80s. I don't remember when it came out, but we saw it in Louisiana at my grandparents. So this movie was a big deal to me growing up. I could not watch it again for the film. I mean, for the book. I couldn't find a copy. I wasn't going to buy some like $100 bootleg thing. And so I did have to write about it from memory. And I watched the few available video clips. But so it's this movie that like Disney has hidden, but they can't fully hide it because James Baskett won the Academy Award. Zippity doo dah is everywhere. They had a ride based on the Splash Mountain. I think that's the name of the ride in Disney World. That's like based on the movie.
What else?
And so the movie's.
Let me say a couple of things quickly.
You bring to it what you're carrying the lead in a weird kind of way.
And he's younger than I am, I believe, when they filmed this, and he looks to be 1,000 years old. I mean, if you look up close, maybe he looks a little bit younger, but
I wish that Disney weren't hiding it, honestly, because it's giving the movie power that it doesn't necessarily have. Disney has like plenty of racist films that you can watch. Birth of a Nation is everywhere, right? I mean, there's a part of me that I don't know, like Disney's doing it because they don't want to get criticized. I believe like they're the ones doing it. It's not like, you know, left-wing progressives like that have like erased it. And I'm left-wing. I'm not criticizing that. I'm saying though, like, it's troubling. I know the movie's troubling, right? But I don't see any value in keeping it hidden in their vaults. I don't.
Yeah, it's a really, I mean, obviously the whole story with Uncle Remus stories is one of cultural appropriation. You know, what's interesting about this film is how it's showcasing Black folklore as the stories did originally, but at the same time, it's kind of making it possible for the white children to have this power. Although the film does have friendships between white and Black children in the neighborhood. So they're very, as Ben says, there are a lot of different cross currents in the film, and it's a landmark in certain ways. So Ben, time is galloping along. We want to talk a bit about some Erskine Caldwell.
Right.
So I suggest we choose between Tobacco Road and God's Little Acre.
All right. I'll talk really quickly. Let's do Tobacco Road, even though God's Little Acre is the much better film. Okay, so Erskine Caldwell is a Georgia writer. He was a huge smash. He's terrible. He's nasty. He's mean. He's tasteless. And he's a vicious writer in a lot of ways. And these are his virtues. And he wrote, I'm not a fan. I've read 10 of his novels or something, and they're ghastly, but they were big sellers. And so John Ford directed this adaptation, Tobacco Road, set in Georgia in 1941, I believe, in a string when John Ford was on fire. Like, he was making one masterpiece after another. And so this film follows a poor, destitute white group of a family of, like, they're not even farmers. They're parasites that just hang around. And they're at the end of everything. And the film is so cruel in its depiction of these people. And this is the same guy who did Grapes of Wrath that gives the Okies integrity and dignity, and they're struggling. And this same guy, same director, he's not responsible for the content, but he makes this film called Tobacco Road. And it gives us the poor Southerner as a Morlock, as a vampire, you know, as dumb and ignorant and rapey. And so this clip we're going to watch has Ward Bond with a croaker sack of turnips, and he's going to the family of the woman he married because he's complaining about something. It doesn't matter what he's complaining about, and they attack him. And if you watch how it's filmed, the movie's not very good. It's loud, but it's filmed well. And if you watch how it's filmed, they are very sinister in how they start to like encroach on Ward Bond. And this film's important.
And it's in that, that line with Deliverance and 2000 Maniacs and Trapped. And, you know, there's a thousand of these films. And I would say this is like one of the first big ones that I can, that I found.
It's, you know, it's, so we're moving from the kind of plantation set, kind of romanticized view of the South to Caldwell's depictions of absolute poverty and portrayed in a very ribald way. That is both, you know, well, in this case is mocking very, very seriously and effectively. So again, Ward Bond has a bag of radishes. The family he's visiting, his in-laws, are starving, and they scheme to get them the radishes from him. So let's take a look.
Love, will you tell me what it is you got in that croaker sack? I've been looking at it ever since you come here, and Lord knows I'm just dying to know.
Tourists by cracking!
Turnips? I ain't had me a good turnip since a year ago last spring, you know. Good Lord only knows how bad I wanted one. You know, I could eat me that whole croaker sack full of turnips. I could eat me a whole wagon load full of turnips between now and sundown.
Don't need a look for me to give you none, because I ain't.
That's a whopping mean thing to say to her poor old pa.
Ain't you gonna give me just a bite, love?
No.
I'll tell you what I'll do, love. I'll make you trade for some of them turnips.
Just to explain, this is Jean Turney, who is not Ward Bond's wife. She's the younger sister of Ward Bond's wife. But she's doing something to try to seduce him as well.
I ain't trading turnips with nobody.
I tell you what, if you'll give me some of them turnips, I'll go down to your house the first thing in the morning, and I'll tell Porter she's got to behave herself. I'll tell her that ain't no way to treat a man who's gone to the bother of marrying her. And I'll tell her she's got to stop hiding in them bushes and ask if it's going to rain. And
You're going to get your hair cut.
What do you say, Lil?
I don't gotta pay you for that. I already give you some quilts and 2 quarts of cylinder oil and $7 to marry Pearl. And that's enough. You gotta make her behave for nothing.
Just one little bitty bite, love.
Ain't no use you niggling at me.
Love. Please, love.
All my children all the time blaming me because the good Lord made me poverty stricken. Them and them all the time bawling me out because they ain't got nothing to eat as if I had anything to do with it. Sometimes it looks to me like the good Lord's got it in good and plenty for a poor man, but I ain't complaining. No, sir, I ain't complaining.
Oh! Oh!
Oh!
Even grandma and the dog, family dog, are in on this operation.
And I think it's a fascinating movie, but I was very troubled by this this theme that I saw in tons of films where like rural Southerners they're not just useless, they're violent, they're dangerous, they're vermin, you know. The lead actor, Charlie Grapewind, I think is his name, he kind of gives his character a little something near the end, but the film is very troubling to me because it's, you know, all people, you know, have value and should be, you know, treated with some dignity. But I never found in the South, like I get lost, I would drive on back roads, I would talk to people. I never met anyone like that. I mean, I just don't, you know, I don't think that's a real thing. And yet we have so many films that could tie into that. And a lot of them are good ones. I mean, Deliverance is a masterpiece, but it ties into that kind of trajectory.
Yeah. And so, you know, we were saying this is not a great film, but in terms of cultural impact and the national imaginary of the South, you know, this, as we were saying before, is the other extreme. It's another vision. One of the other defining characteristics of the South is the importance of religion. And so we wanted to talk a little bit, and again, time is just flying by, Ben. So I'm thinking maybe we'll just talk about Junebug, because Ben writes so eloquently about the depiction of religion in the South, its importance to the South as a defining characteristic. And we also have to say, many of you have probably seen Junebug. It came out some years ago, but to cut to the chase, Ben actually writes in his book, if there's only one film you watch after reading my book, it's Junebug. So why don't we, I don't know if you want to say anything.
I'll just speak quickly. I was raised Southern Baptist and was publicly saved multiple times. And I don't live that way now, but I think religion is treated so shabbily on screen in a lot of ways, where like they'll focus on one aspect when religion is like marbled through life in the South. And so it's a positive and negatives are often flattened. And so you end up with like religion as like a demonic force. It's a pretty common thing in a lot of films, which is, I mean, crazy, or religion is this just kind of feel good thing that you know, is out there. And I don't think either of those are accurate at all. Junebug gets to the ineffable, right? It's like it's religious belief that you cannot understand and you won't understand. So you can show them.
And so, Junebug is about a North Carolina man who has a career in Chicago. He falls in love with an art dealer there, and then they come back to his home. It's a whirlwind marriage, courtship and marriage, and he's bringing her home. She's looking at a folk artist in the area. But then there's this scene where they go to church, and her husband, the lead character, played by Alessandro Nivolo, is very friendly with the pastor. And so at this after service gathering, he prevails upon George, the Nivolo character, to sing a hymn. So you wanna watch him singing the hymn, but as Ben points out, also watch his wife, played by M. Beth Davids, who's been around the world and has never been to the South, as she responds to his singing. So let's not forget to share screen, Matthew, and here we go.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching for you and for me. Come home, come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling all sinners.
I love her acting. Yeah.
Go ahead, Ben.
I love her acting in that because it's like a negative epiphany. I mean, usually in a movie like this, the characters are like, they've come to some understanding about God or like faith, but she's almost appalled. I mean, she doesn't understand what she's looking, watching, and her face is like registering. It's almost distasteful. I don't know. It's really, you know, and they don't tell you what she's thinking, but it's a fabulous movie. And, you know, it gets to the heart of Southern belief, which Christianity, sorry, which is complex, right? And is like good and bad. It's also just a great film. But
I read her reaction here differently. I read it as just kind of a sense of wonder. But as you put it in the book, she's like, who is this man I've married? Like, I've never seen this side of this guy before.
Yeah.
And she really is a fish out of water in the South, but she's also this very confident woman who is in some ways oblivious to how her husband's family are regarding her. And then we neglected to say, this was the breakthrough movie with the marvelous Amy Adams, the first of her, I think, six nominations for Best Actor or Best Supporting Actress. So it really is kind of a marvel in those ways. To make sure we have time to take your questions, I'm gonna suggest that we choose one more film then to talk about. So we have lots of choices. It could be Nothing But a Man. It could be Queen and Slim. We're also thinking of My Cousin Vinny, just for fun.
Well, maybe School Days or Nothing. Let's do School Days, if that's okay.
Sure.
Because I still think it's a lesser known Spike Lee film, right? And it's set in Georgia, and it's a historically Black college, and it's a great movie, and it's a view of Spike Lee. I don't think people, non-cinephiles, I don't think are quite aware of this other movie he made.
Yeah.
Do you want me to set? Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
No. So this was Spike Lee's second film. You know, he makes this breakthrough, low budget, funded on credit cards film, She's Gotta Have It, in 1986. Or 87, and then Columbia Pictures signs him, and he makes a musical about a historically Black college and Greek life based on his actual experiences attending Clark Atlanta. And he shot it here in Atlanta. So, you know, we celebrate how Atlanta has become a center of filmmaking, really, for the first time in its history. You know, we had the Burt Reynolds 70s, and you know, we had Driving Miss Daisy at the end of the, but you know, this really, this precedes, you know, sort of the taking off with Tyler Perry and everything else. So, but he fashioned it as a struggle between two different fraternities, one led by Lawrence Fishburne, that's very politically alert, and another led by Giancarlo Esposito, which is not politically engaged at all. And then you have the bifurcation in the two fraternities between their women. And you get into colorism in the film, lighter skinned women versus darker skinned women. And so this scene shows the rivalry between these two parallel sororities. And then it breaks out into a musical number about hair. So Black hair. So let's take a look.
The word is excuse me.
Nobody told you to stand in the hall either. Excuse me.
That's better, Miss Thing.
Uh-uh. Ooh. It's not real.
Say what? You heard. It ain't even real.
You wish you had hair like this.
Girl, you know you weren't even born with blue eyes.
That's right. Blue contact lenses.
They're just jealous.
Right. Jealous.
Rachel. I've been watching you look at Julian. You're not slick.
If that was true, he wasn't much to look at.
Pickaninny.
Barbie doll.
High yellow heifer.
Tar baby.
Wanna be white, jigaboo.
Don't start.
We're gonna finish it.
Riri, open up!
Hello.
wish you had hair like this. Then the boys give you a kiss. Talk about nothing but bliss. Then you're gonna see what you missed.
If a flash should land on your head, then I'm sure he'd break all his legs. Cause you got so much grease up there. Dear, is that a weave that you wear?
Well, you got talk of us standing all over your head.
Right. So, I mean, you know, there's this great audacity in Spike Lee making a film like this. And lest you think, well, this could be set in any historically black college, he actually has a very striking scene in which some of the fraternity brothers go out into Atlanta and get into an argument with some black Atlantan residents at a fast food place. So, you know, Spike Lee has changed the course of film history in so many ways, but he, even though he was on the court rooting for the Knicks through the Knicks-Hawks series, he was born in Atlanta and attended Clark Atlanta. So this is Atlanta filmmaking. And it precedes a lot of other musicals set in and around black Atlanta, like Drumline and Stomp the Yard and other films to come. So obviously there is so much to the South on screen, the imaginary South, the way it intersects with our own experiences of the South. We've focused our conversation, and believe me, Ben and I could do this for another hour easily and help you fall asleep. But you know, just to convey the diversity of ideas and depictions of the South, Ben's book is just an excellent guide. It's a great read, and I hope all of you will pick up a copy and start watching. So, Claire, can we start seeing what questions we have from folks attending tonight?
Yeah, of course. And thank you both so much for such an interesting conversation. So we have a few questions in the Q&A and a few others that we want to get through that we got via email. So the first one is from Charles, who's attending tonight. He was wondering, what did you both think of Jean Renault's The Southerner with Zachary Scott?
I mean, it's, you know, so it's one of the great movies that I discovered for this book. I actually watched it for the book, and I really like that director. He, you know, is one of the great directors with Rules of the Game and Grand Illusion. But The Southerner, even though it's a seminal film, and it's exactly the kind of movie. It's like, why don't more filmmakers make movies like this? Honestly. It's rooted in these characters in a specific locale, and they're struggling against their situation, and they have dignity, but they're flawed. They're not, you know, and it's kind of funny. It's kind of thrilling. It's very dramatic. It's a wonderful film. And I would say, you know, at the top of any to watch list, especially if you live in the South.
Yeah. I mean, Jean Renoir is a director with a superb sense of place. So, you know, he's fleeing the Nazis when they invade France. He comes to Hollywood. He's not treated at all with the kind of respect that he deserves as a major, major world figure in film history. Yet he's able to craft this really remarkable low budget, didn't make money, almost forgotten film. So Charles, really glad you brought this film up, because it's another one that Ben talks about at some length and gives it its due. So thank you.
Thank you both. This question is something I was thinking of when you were talking about Gone with the Wind specifically, but it's true of other films too. So Andrea says, I've always found it interesting that a number of the actors who play iconic Southern characters were not actually from the South. So there's nothing wrong with that per se, but she's curious. They're obviously projecting their sense of what it means to be Southern. So can you talk about that a little bit? Or do we need another hour for that?
It's a complex subject, but I'll say a few little things. Like, you know, Paul Newman and Marlon Brando played like seminal Southern characters in Tennessee Williams plays, and they were both born in the Midwest somewhere. And I think part of it has to do with the South. I think it was the essayist Sullivan, Jeremiah Sullivan, said the South breeds plenty of geniuses, but has no real culture of its own in the sense of a structure, right? And Atlanta's now does have it, but I think that we had Tallulah Bankhead, right? But like the South didn't have there's a ambulance going by, sorry. The South didn't have like, I don't know if this is the truth, but I'm betting the South did not have a system to create great movie actors, right? So you, like, I wanted to work in the movies. I'll use my own. I wanted to work in the movies. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to do special effects and be like behind the scenes. And I grew up in Pensacola, Florida, and Hollywood. It was a million miles away. I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know how to, like, I had no road or a way to get there. And so imagine 50 years before that, right? And so I think that's the practical answer. The representational answer, I mean, you know, that's a whole book.
Yeah. So much of our film history, and especially what we're most familiar with, is American history and Hollywood. You know, there were Southerners in Hollywood, but there weren't a lot. I mean, we showed that scene from Tobacco Road. That screenwriter, Nunnally Johnson, I think it's from Macon, and he was extremely successful for multiple decades. There's a little known screenwriter from Atlanta, Lamar Trotty. He wrote Ford's Young Mr. Lincoln and Wilson, and The Oxbow Incident, one of the great anti-lynching films of all time. Today we have Holly Hunter, Steve Soderbergh was born in Atlanta. You keep finding more and more people who come from Atlanta. And then we also have people who are in Atlanta creating culture. So, you know, and because I'm a film historian and I'm very interested in representations of the South, Hollywood is predominantly people from the North, from the Midwest. You have filmmakers who are Jewish, you know, European emigres. This is a national issue. They regard the South as a foreign country, certainly in the classical era, by which I mean up through 1960. And so you have that difficulty. And then you have people like Nunnally Johnson and Lamar Trotty, who are brought in as kind of experts. A great historian once called them professional Southerners, and they're giving them advice, right? Much like Susan Myrick gave Selznick advice, channeling Margaret Mitchell's perspectives in the making of Gone with the Wind. And so I think, you know, we are finding an incredible flourishing right now that can include actors from the South, as well as stories about the South, and, you know, movies like Moonlight and Mudbound and Mud, and, you know, Matthew McConaughey from Texas, quintessentially Texas. So it's always a problem. I guess we would call it Southern face, you know, to have these actors who are not from the South. Jessica Tandy's from London, playing Miss Daisy, or at Frying Green Tomatoes. So it's a continuing issue. But it's fascinating.
Ben, you mentioned earlier that your original draft of this book was over 700 pages, and that you had a very patient editor, aka your wife, which that's a real strong marriage right there. But I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the thing that was the hardest for you to let go of that didn't make it into this book as a film buff.
A lot of Matthew's gonna laugh because the book has digressions. Well, let me say, I'm like a failed novelist. Like, I was writing novels, no one wanted to read them. I wasn't even submitting them anymore. I was just writing novels. And I've been writing for about 20 years. And I decided, for a variety of reasons, to write a book about Southern movies, because there really wasn't anything, you know, non-academic out there. And I was gonna write it with Randa Williams, who's a friend. We wrote This Day in Civil Rights History together. He backed out after I submitted a chapter, and he was like, you know what, I think you don't need me. right? He's a big movie fan too. He was like, I don't think you need me. Did you do it? So I didn't know how to structure the book. So the book, I tried different things. And initially it was going to be one film kind of illuminating all these other types of movies in a chapter, which I did in the Nashville and the Southern musical and country music. That was going to be the setup, but it didn't really make sense with a William Faulkner or Tennessee Williams, or frankly, Flannery O'Connor, who's really important, but they only made one film adaptation of her work, even though I think she's like a dominant presence, even by her absence. So anyway, I'll tell you the chapter that hurt the most. I was so proud of I returned to the personal in the 2000s and my own political awakening and my own, I became a man and I was living through history. And I was so proud of this chapter, and it was 80 pages. And this was during COVID, my wife's editing it. She ended up working for the company that put it out. So, she's editing it. She's an amazing editor, and I owe her everything. However, it was personal for me. I had spent 8 years writing this book, and she's like just throwing it, cutting it. And so I said, well, this chapter is like, I'm not an arrogant person. I'm really not. But I was like, this chapter is like, gold. Right. And she cut 2/3 of it. And I was just devastated. I was gutted. But she was right. She was right. But I felt like the spice and all of my work had been, thrown out. Anyway.
Sounds like we need The South Plays Itself Part 2.
I've made that joke. Yeah, I've said, that's going to be the sequel.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like you set up this question perfectly. You mentioned in your bio that you're always writing a book. Are you able to tell us what you're working on now, or are you just enjoying that this one's published a little
bit? No. I've got two books done, almost done. One is a biography of Joseph H. Lewis, which I allude to in this book. I sort of accidentally pitched it to a guy Matthew and I both know who blurbed this book, and it's done. I'm like 2 pages away from finishing. And then the other book is about, it's like a punk early 80s juvenile delinquent movies from like 82, 83, and 84. It's a short, angry read. It's about Pensacola too. And it's called The Bad Class. And it's also, I'm not quite finished, but so I have two other books like that are almost done, and they both have contracts, and I'm excited. They're not as important to me as this book, but I still, I'm trying to make up for lost time.
That's really impressive. Congratulations. That's a huge feat. So we're getting to the end of our time tonight. So I have one final question for both of you, and it's kind of a hard one. So it's like, you go through this huge journey in the book. Guys, if you haven't read the book yet, it goes through just a dizzying array of films, just so much to absorb. So much care and thought put into it. You can see as you read it, but you get to the question you have to answer, which is, okay, out of all of these films that you've looked at and the hundreds of them that didn't make it into this book, what do you both of y'all think about? What is the movie that does show the South in its most authentic self? Where is the movie where you think the South gets closest to actually playing itself?
Matthew, do you want to go first, or do you want me to go?
I mean, from my perspective, and you've seen more of these films than I have, I mean, I would say Junebug. I think that's a contender.
I would say, so for religion, I would say Junebug. For Reconstruction, which we have so few films about, I would say The Free State of Jones, which is, it's so hard to watch. It's really well made, great acting, brutally hard to watch because the Empire Strikes Back, right? It's like the bad guys win. Moonlight to me is like personal and beautiful. And like, it's in this part, like black, gay Miami. Like we don't ever see that. And it's steeped in cinema. Like watching it is like getting a class, like 5 classes in cinema. And I would say The Southerner, which the other questioner mentioned. And then finally, I know you said one movie, but I can't do it. And then, honestly, maybe My Cousin Vinny, because it's the regional differences as humorous and mutual misunderstanding. And an undereducated New Yorker arguing with an uneducated Southerner, and it's funny. You know, it's not mocking or bitter, and everyone's seen it. But
yeah, no, it's delightful, and you know, certainly in the courtroom scenes, you have, again, we've talked about how filmmakers so often predominantly have a perspective on the South that is from outside the South. And here you have a film, a comedy, where there's miscommunication, a la Cool Hand Luke, but it's the Northerner who's really out of his element. And the courtroom becomes this almost neutral space, but it's presided over by this kind of benign Southern judge. And so it's kind of a wonderful reversal of who's the fish out of water here, but in a very gentle and humane and generous way. So yes, My Cousin Vinny.
Well, thank you both so much. And we had someone post in the Q&A, they wanted to see if we could put together a list of like the top films that we would recommend, you know, to watch to get impression of all the different ideas of the South. So I think we can, you know, get some ideas from Ben and include those. And we do a follow-up email to all of you on the event tonight. So we'll include that in the follow-up. But I'm afraid that's all the time we have tonight. Ben and Matthew, thank you so much for such an interesting conversation. And again, The South Never Plays Itself is available for purchase from Acapella Books. They have a great feature where you can actually get free in-town delivery if you're inside the perimeter, or you can always go pick it up. So lots of ways to purchase it. You'll find all of your summer plans there, lots of films to watch, highly recommend it. We have, if you enjoyed tonight, we have lots of author talks coming up in June. Two next week, which I'm extremely excited about. On Monday, we're going to be welcoming Annette Gordon-Reed to discuss her new book on Juneteenth, and she will be in conversation with Virginia Prescott, so that's free. It's at 7 p.m. on Monday, and you can find those registration details at atlantahistorycenter.com. We also have a fun local history book on Tuesday. Martin Padgett is going to be in conversation with Philip Rafshoon, and he'll be talking about his new book, A Night at the Sweet Gum Head, Drag, Drugs, Disco, and Atlanta's Gay Revolution. So that's going to be a lot of fun. That's Tuesday night, the 8th at 7. All those details and more at atlantahistorycenter.com. So we hope to see you during more virtual author talks this summer. So Ben and Matthew, thank you again for joining us tonight. Everyone in the audience, thanks so much. And everyone have a good night.
Thank you, Claire. Thanks, Ben. Great fun talking.
Thanks, Matthew.
Let's do it.
Thanks, Claire.